So I finally went and got myself one of these. This is a measurement microphone, the sort of thing you can use to measure how an in-ear monitor or Bluetooth earbud actually sounds. Except there's like 15, 20 other guys that already do this. Some of them maintain databases online that you can go check out right now. Some of them have over 1,000 measurements already there. Nerds. So what can I bring to the table? What can I do that should be there in the market and it's not there yet? Today's video, we're going to be building an amateur active noise cancelling measuring rig and settling this debate once and for all. Which has the best ANC? And is the Google Pixel Buds really not as good as the Sony XM4? Of course, this might go very wrongly for me, but who doesn't like watching a good train wreck, am I right? First, we need something that can generate the sound. That'll do. Of course, then we'll need the microphone at the other end to actually record whatever's coming out of the speakers. But really what we also need is a laptop like this one to run a software called REW or Room EQ Wizard. Excellent software. I'm probably only using 5% of what it can do, if that. The idea is generate the noise signal from this laptop, send it through the amp to the speakers, then have a microphone on the other side with our Bluetooth earbud affixed on the microphone. Basically, the noise will come out of here, it'll get noise cancelled by this Bluetooth earbud, get recorded via the microphone back onto our laptop, and then we've got two signals to compare, the original noise signal and the noise cancel signal, and then we just find out how much this little guy actually cancelled out. Simple, right? Well, not quite. See, there are a couple of issues. For one, this amplifier here tends to have its own EQ settings and its own digital signal processing, which adds whatever flavor it wants to add to the sound. We don't want that. Thankfully, it has something called a pure direct mode, which basically kills all that DSP and just amplifies whatever you give it. The next component though is the speaker. The speaker itself, this is not a studio speaker. It does not have a flat frequency response curve, which would be ideal. This is just a bookshelf speaker, a budget one at that. Pretty good for $300 or so, I'd say. It's the Monitor Audio Bronze BX2. And the fact that it doesn't have a flat frequency response is actually okay, because what we're actually measuring here is not the frequency response of the Bluetooth earbud or in fact the speaker itself. All we're doing is measuring a difference between two signals. So as long as we can measure this reliably, we have our reference signal, whatever that might look like. And as long as we can measure that going through the Bluetooth earbud, getting cancelled and then being recorded onto the microphone, we just compare those two signals and we see how much attenuation has happened. But there's actually two reasons why I would still prefer a flat frequency response curve. See, reason number one is that if you want to do an experiment consistently over and over again, then it's better to have some things as constant as possible, and the easiest way to do that is have a flat frequency response curve. The second reason is presentation. It is far more intuitive to just have a flat frequency response at, say, I don't know, 90 decibels as your reference guide, and then below that, just superimpose all the noise cancelled waveform, and then you can see how much, you can literally just see how much it has reduced in various places. It's just easier for the viewer to see. So I think going forward, if I want to make this a database, that's how I probably want to present it. It can be done another way. Sound Guys, the website, actually just publishes their attenuation graphs, but that's more work and I'm lazy. And the software has an auto EQ function anyway, and everybody knows less work is more better. But that's not all. See, this is a living room. This is not a controlled environment. It's not a studio. It's certainly not an anechoic chamber, which you can probably tell from my voice. There are resonances, there are reflections off the window, there's modes, there's lots of things that interfere with the actual measurement process. And to make matters worse, this sort of device is not really meant for this sort of measurement. This coupler, this kind of mic, is only meant to measure things that create sound right over here in what is basically an artificial ear canal. And that's a problem. Now, the easiest way to solve that problem is to keep the microphone close to the speaker. On the one hand, the microphone itself is more likely to pick up the signal. On the other, it's too close for other reflections in the room to actually affect the microphone measurement. Now, we also don't want it too close so that it's only getting sound from this diaphragm alone or this one. We need a combination of that woofer and tweeter for full range. So I'd figure something about here should be okay, but at this point, I'm just eyeballing it. We're gonna have to measure it and adjust accordingly. Let's set it up. Yes, I'm using a selfie stick as a makeshift microphone mount. This is how the pros do it. So I've got everything set up. I've got Room EQ Wizard running. I've set my outputs to go through the amp. I've set the amp on pure direct, so it's not doing anything in the middle. I've got the speaker and I've got the microphone pointing at the speaker connected back to my laptop. So at this point, we just have to make a measurement. Okay, so it looks like we've made our first measurement and, well, as you can see, it's not flat. But I've used auto EQ, I've got a bunch of filters that I'm applying to any signal this laptop will now output to the speaker. So let's run the measurements again and see if it's actually EQ'd to flat this time. And there we have it. We've got two curves. One was the original curve and the other one is, well, it's not perfectly flat, but it's flat enough for us. I think this is pretty good. From this point on, we can start actually measuring IEMs. Now, this might seem a little jank to you. I mean, I'm using a selfie stick to prop up the microphone, but really what's important here is just the distance of the microphone to the speaker and the height at which it's aligned to the speaker. As long as those things remain constant, it's okay, no matter how many experiments I do. Plus, the fact that we can actually get a usable result means that the placement is okay. Now, from the graph, we see that this is only usable between about maybe 100, 150 hertz, all the way up to maybe 6, maybe 7 kilohertz. And beyond that, I don't really seem to get a response. That could be a number of things. That could be either me doing something wrong or just a limitation of this microphone or the way I'm setting it up. But that's okay, because luckily, most of the noise in any environment that you're likely to encounter is going to be in that frequency range. So for all intents and purposes, this is a working measuring device right now. This is it. Now we just have to see if it actually works with a Bluetooth IEM in it. Okay, so a couple of quick things about the Bluetooth earbud. Number one, this is not the original foam tip. So I'm just gonna install the original Sony Linkbuds foam tip so no one can say that we were cheating. And also, once we put this in the coupler like so, the problem is all of them now have in-ear detection, which means if they detect that they're not in the ear, then the ANC usually just turns off. That's okay though. If you can see, there's a little bit of a photoelectric sensor right there that basically senses light and darkness. And if it senses darkness, it assumes that it's in your ear. I'm gonna use this little bit of post-it and put it right over the sensor. And I can hear, because I've got the other one in my other ear, I can hear that it's gone into ANC mode because both of them go into ANC mode together. Now we just put it here and we should be good to go. Of course, all this is because I don't have one of those fake ears, those fake pinnas. Maybe in the future I'll get one of those and I'll be able to measure headphones as well. So if you subscribe to this channel, maybe one day we can fund that purchase as well. Okay, so just so we make sure we're not messing this up, we're gonna make two measurements, one with it in ambient sound mode and one with it in noise cancelling to make sure that the noise cancelling is actually working and it's bringing something down. Okay, you see how the green line is below the blue line? The blue line's our reference point. That's without any Bluetooth earbud, that is the reference signal. There's a little bit of passive isolation also because of the earbud itself, but that's pretty much the transparency mode. Now let's check if the active noise cancelling mode does anything different. Okay, so we've made two measurements now, one with active noise cancelling off and ambient sound mode on, and one with active noise cancelling. You see that top blue line, that's the reference line. The green line below that, ignore that, that's with the ambient sound mode on, we don't need that. But the bottom blue line, that's with the ANC on. So you can see that right over here between sort of 1 kilohertz and 4 kilohertz, there's a big dip here. Around 3 kilohertz, there's a huge dip. So it's doing a lot of noise cancelling over there, and it's doing some noise cancelling at the lower frequencies as well. It's pretty straightforward, but right here between the 500 and 800 hertz, well, it seems to do a little less for whatever reason. Now, even if I upload these on a database or on the YouTube community or on my Twitter, go and follow, don't use them standalone because this whole thing is not done with scientific rigor. It's just an amateur DIY project. So by itself, these readings should be unusable. But as long as you're keeping all of this constant and we replace the Sony Linkbuds S with the PixelBuds Pro or the XM4, then we can certainly compare them and see which is better or worse. Or at least that's my theory. We just have to test it out now. Okay, so we've made our measurements. Now it's judgment time. I'm going to do two things. One, I'm going to compare my measurements with that of Sound Guys. Now, Sound Guys is a website that does a testing of a lot of audio equipment, including the PixelBuds Pro, and they happen to have tested the active noise cancellation as well, which means I can test my measurements against theirs. That's step one. If my measurement holds good and is at least comparable to theirs, it means, first of all, that we have created a good rig that compares with people who have much, much better equipment. And second, it means that we can go on to the next step, comparing the PixelBuds Pro with the Sony Linkbuds S and the WF-1000XM4 to see which is better and how. Okay, first off, we've got the Sound Guys curve on the left. You can see the green dashed line, that's the ANC line for the PixelBuds Pro. The blue line over here in REW, that is mine. Now, they're actually not supposed to look the same. Sound Guys actually posts an attenuation graph. So what this says is at 100 dB, the PixelBuds Pro gave approximately 25 decibels of attenuation, 25 decibels of noise cancellation. And to keep it very simple, let's just analyze the Sound Guys graph. Okay, what I can see from 100 Hertz onwards, because that's what I can compare with, is that there is a fair bit of attenuation all the way till about 500 Hertz, right in the middle over here. And then it just sort of starts falling off. Around the 200 to 300 Hertz mark, it starts falling off, and all the way down to about 700-800 Hertz, where it's only a 10 dB drop. Then after that, it goes up again and reaches a peak somewhere between 2 and 4 kilohertz, where it does quite a bit of attenuation, and then it drops off again and increases again. Now, if we look at my side of things, that red line up there, that is the reference line, and the blue line is how much of a cut it was. So again, between 100 and 300 Hertz, you can see there's a lot of attenuation. Like, what was up here at 90 dB is now down here at, like, what, 65 dB or something? About 30, 35 dB, which is matching with what Sound Guy's graph is also saying. And then after 300 Hertz, right up to about 800 Hertz, the attenuation reduces. At about 700 Hertz, we can see that, you know, it's not far off from the reference line, which means not much noise was cancelled over there. And then again, it starts dropping off to reach a low point at 3 kilohertz. If you look at Sound Guys, 1, 2, 3, 3 kilohertz is the highest attenuation. And in my graph, 3 kilohertz, also the highest attenuation. So it seems to be correlating pretty darn well with the Sound Guys graph. The graph generated by a website that has probably thousands of dollars worth of equipment. So that's a win for you and me, for us DIYers, for us amateur audiophiles who just really want to get a little objectivity in. Now, step two is to concentrate on our measurements alone and open it up to the Linkbuds S as well as the XM4. So let's do that. So that's the Linkbuds S first of all. 100 to 200 Hertz, they're actually reasonably comparable. And in fact, I would say right up to 400 Hertz, the Pixel, or even 500 Hertz, the PixelBuds Pro actually does much better. Outside of my apartment, there's this other apartment with this huge air conditioning unit with a lot of low bass rumble. This is what it cut out. So it felt very good. But when I got onto the road next door and there was a little traffic, then that's changed my mind about the quality of ANC a little bit. And I think we might be able to see that, because if you see beyond 500 Hertz, the green line, by the way, that's the Linkbuds S, that's a lot more attenuation than the PixelBuds. And then beyond that, I mean, throughout the frequency range, except for this little bump over here between 2.8 and 3K, everything else, the green line is way below the blue line, and therefore the Linkbuds S does a heck of a lot better above 500 Hertz. Below 500 Hertz, the PixelBuds fares a little bit better. Overall, I think, generally speaking, the Linkbuds S does a better job because it just does a more consistent level of attenuation overall. But if a lot of your noise is coming in that low frequency range, then the PixelBuds might actually sound better to you. Now, if we go and look at the XM4, I mean, just look at that orange line. Yes, between 200-300 Hertz, PixelBuds Pro is still better. It does a better job. I mean, beyond that, it's just not even funny. The XM4 just wallops the PixelBuds. Massive amounts of attenuation throughout the frequency range is just incredible. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is why the XM4 is still the top tier. The PixelBuds Pro is, you know, it's sort of comparable with the Sony Linkbuds S, but even so, the Sony Linkbuds S, an older Bluetooth IEM, still has better ANC. And there you have it. We have successfully created a DIY active noise cancellation measurement rig. I'm really excited about this. I think this will actually deliver a lot of value to the audience. And at some point, I would like to upload these online so that you can actually go through and look at them like you do with the frequency response curves of various IEMs. But I'll keep you posted on that if you promise to hit that subscribe button, because I'll make it a community post when I put it out there. My Twitter is also a place where I will be announcing when the Squiglink link goes up. Follow me on Twitter, address is down below. I'll see you in the next one. Stay happy, stay peaceful, stay colorful. Namaste.